Over the past 100 years, KCI has made its footprint on the city of St. Louis and beyond. It's built homes, churches, schools, roads, bridges, industrial plants, offices, concert halls, and even high-rise buildings. You name it, KCI has done it. And it's because of you that KCI is still here. You are the heart and soul of this company. You recognize that you're part of something bigger, and you're proud of the work you do. You are builders, not brokers. You are KCI. In 1922, just a few years after World War I, 31-year-old Charles Closter opened a construction business.
My dad always said that Grandpa was a carpenter from the beginning and was a pretty good businessman. And actually, when he started the company, he had a partner. And the name of the company, I believe, was Closter Snyderhound.
Ultimately, Charles continued as the sole owner, and the Closter Company was born. He started in a small office on Grand before moving the operation to 4607 Beck Avenue in South City.
When they started, they built some homes. They built Catholic churches, schools.
Construction was on the rise in St. Louis, and Charles began to make a name for himself with little more than a wheelbarrow and truck.
My grandfather had a reputation of being a very straightforward, hardworking, bright man. And we were sort of proud of that.
The Closter Company continued focusing on residential, commercial, and school construction right through World War II. After serving in the war, two of his sons came to work for him, first George, then his older brother, Barney.
Both of them learned the business from my grandfather. They learned to read contracts, understand responsibility. They were always taught to live up to their obligations, live up to their contracts.
George and Barney were both bright guys and enjoyed success in their new roles.
While they were brothers, they were totally different, had totally different personalities. Early on, my dad became the outside guy and my uncle Barney was the inside guy. He handled the estimates, the billing, the receivables. My dad was the outside guy. He ran the field. All the men reported to my dad. By the late 50s, he was spending a lot of time in Florida with my grandmother. And at that time, my dad and uncle were running the company.
Charles formed a partnership with his sons, George and Barney, in 1957. Before ultimately selling his shares to his sons in 1961 for $20,000. He passed away in November of that same year, after nearly 40 years in business. Once they rang in the new year in 1962, George and Barney were officially the sole owners of the company. A year later, they were incorporated as Closter Company Incorporated.
In the early days when my uncle and my dad took over from my grandfather, they were successful. I think they had done mostly schools, churches. They did a little bit of commercial work, and it was later into the 60s and then 70s, they got into hospital work, municipal work, public works. Most of their work was lump sum hard bid, which they were very good at.
Closter Company's evolution into its modern form began in the 70s. The earliest known bridge project, titled Bridge in company records, happened in 1971. And 1972 saw its biggest project to date. St. Anthony's Hospital.
So when St. Anthony's Hospital decided to relocate from South City to South County, they took bids and Closter Company was the low bidder and built the entire hospital from ground up. It was the biggest project that George and Barney had undertaken. It took the vast majority of the company resources to build that project. Almost every superintendent and foreman that they had was on that job. And it was an award-winning concrete project. Those walls are concrete, white concrete.
The success with St. Anthony's set the stage for many other projects around town. With George as the boss in the field and Barney as the boss in the office, the company was thriving.
My dad and uncle had tremendous respect for each other. They had an agreement long before we were ever around that they were going to stay together. Their relationship was more important than the business.
As George and Barney celebrated the 50th anniversary of Closter Company, it was time to begin looking toward the future, which began with George's three sons.
So when I went to work, Carl was already there in the office. George was either still in the field or recently in the office, but George dealt with manpower, tools, and equipment. Carl was the protege of Barney, so he became an estimator.
Nothing was handed to the three brothers. When they started, they all reported to their Uncle Barney.
Well, my Uncle Barney was a very good businessman. He was also a taskmaster and was difficult to work for. But he was very bright and he was very successful, and I learned a lot from Barney. All of us did.
In 1977, Closter Company had outgrown their Beck Avenue office and relocated to 4245 Bi-State Industrial Drive. They were also expanding their talent pool, including hiring two future presidents of the company.
So Rick Grable was a boyhood friend of my brother Carl. Carl hired him, and then after Rick came on board, within a year or two, Doug Jones got hired.
When I got there in 1978, they were a good contractor. They had good people, good superintendents, and they seemed to do the job well.
One of those jobs was the Ferguson Avenue Bridge.
So that job I know pretty well. That was my first job as a project manager that I got to run on my own from start to finish. That was the first concrete I-girder job. And it was the first epoxy-coated steel job. And this steel was delivered and it was all lime green. It was colorful. But it just turned out good. My uncle, in his reserved way, told me I did a good job, which I thought, that was saying something. He never said that very much, but he did say it on that one. I was floating on air.
The next generation was outperforming their predecessors, and it was time to begin a transition.
We reported to Barney, but pretty shortly thereafter, Carl became the boss. And George continued to work his way into running the field, manpower, tools, and equipment. Doug was an estimator project manager. I was an estimator project manager. And Rick was mostly a project manager, did some estimating.
George Sr. was ready to step away, so he and Barney began the process of selling the company.
Barney had two daughters, no sons. Neither of the daughters had any interest in joining the business. And when it was time for Barney and my father to back away, Barney made it very clear he had no interest in simply giving the business to three nephews.
Barney had no sons. George Sr. had three sons. Rick and I were kind of Barney's surrogate sons. So we were his side of the equation, if you will.
It was a family business. I had every reason to believe that it would continue to be a family business. But when it was time for my dad and uncle to move on to the next phase of their lives, they actually sold to five young men, two of whom were not Closters. So that was sort of the first message to me that this was no longer a family business.
Barney and George Sr. stayed on in advisory roles to ensure a smooth transition.
The five of us were well suited in the industry. We were a decent mix of people to come together to be able to build work and make money with it.
They made their mark right from the beginning, contributing to several landmark projects around St. Louis.
The original Closter Company built churches and hospitals and some MSD work. We, the five of us, drug into civil work. We did more roadway work, we did more MSD work. Roadway was Fred Weber. Civil work was all Alberisi. And those were huge companies that we couldn't compete with. We worked for many of them as subcontractors, and we did the work in the field.
We were self-performers, and we were very proud of that. We employed the basic trades. We did our own steel work and our own carpentry, our own concrete work. We felt like that was an advantage for us.
Kloster Company was a trusted subcontractor on many big jobs, including the Southwestern Bell Building.
McCarthy was the construction manager. We bid and got the concrete work.
A unique structure for us because that's 44 stories, and we're pumping concrete from grade, 44 stories vertically.
That was a record for us pumping concrete, and I think it was a record in yards poured. Huge project. That was a Tom Downey job. He was the superintendent. His brother, Bob, died in that project. It was devastating. We have another job, downtown, the huge parking garage, 1,500 cars for St. Louis Center. We had grown enough that we had major pours on the same day on those two projects, St. Louis Center and Bell Telephone. Both pump jobs. Takes a lot of manpower to put a lot of concrete yardage in place. And we were doing that on a daily basis.
With more growth, the evolution of the company continued.
My dad and my uncle never really owned any equipment. They rented.
When I got there in 1978, we had one truck, one air compressor, and one forklift. And that was the entirety of our equipment.
We started buying equipment. So backhoes, high lifts, cranes. We built a pretty nice fleet of our own equipment.
But with the growth came growing pains. And in 1987, President Karl Kloster left to become an executive at McCarthy.
It was just sad that we lost a good player. He left us. We didn't want him to leave, but he left.
We all had our own way of doing things, and we could all get to the same point, but we would all take different paths.
In 1995, Kevin discovered he was ready for a new path.
It was just time for me. I went to work for a real estate developer and learned the process from the owner side.
When Kevin walks in 1995 and decides he's gonna leave, Junior says, I'm not gonna be the last Kloster at Kloster Company. So he leaves with his brother.
After 73 years, Kloster Company was no longer a family business.
Certainly, we were proud of what we did. We built a lot of interesting projects. We were successful. We left our mark on the city.
With the exit of the Klosters, the two remaining owners were Rick Grable and Doug Jones.
When they left, gosh, I'm sorry you're going. I wish you wouldn't, because it's working. But Rick and I had no question that we could continue to run the company. It was Katie bar the door, let's go.
The sale also led to the company being rebranded as KCI.
Kevin said, I need to get the Kloster name out of Kloster Company, Inc. So we did what everybody else had done. Let's just truncate this down to the three letters. It was a good company, it had a reputation. It was associated with those three letters, so it worked well.
Doug and Rick were also working well together, and the company continued to grow under their leadership.
We had an excellent relationship. He handled the field, and I handled the estimating and the office. So it got back to Barney and George, really. We got to the place that we were like an old married couple. At 5 o'clock, he'd wander in my office. We'd talk about what happened during the day and what was working, what wasn't working, and how we're gonna change this to make it work better.
KCI was thriving. And by 2002, it was time to move again to its current location at Lake Bluff Drive. Everything was going great. KCI was tackling bigger projects than ever. Doug and Rick were on top of the world.
We had Christmas parties, and of course, all the guys came in. And Rick was Santa Claus. And he truly had the whole outfit, and we gave away stuff, televisions and rifles and stuff for Christmas. And he just loved every minute of it with a cigar this long.
But then tragedy struck. In 2005, Rick Grable suddenly passed away.
The night before had been an AGC function. sometimes they'd get done with the major function and then they'd go to a bar and then they'd go to another bar. And then, of course, Rick with his cigar, boy, he was into all that. That next morning, I get to the office and here stands Jim and John, who was Rick's best friend, and his wife, Rose. John says, "We lost Rick last night," and it blew me away. I didn't know what to do with that. For me personally, it was a big blow because I lost my partner. And the thing you have to do at that point as the leader is reassure the troops that this is okay. We planned for this. We'll get on through this and keep doing exactly what we've been doing, which is what we did.
As the unexpected sole owner of KCI, Doug now needed to plan for his own departure and began to handpick a team of successors.
In 2008, I said, okay, we need to start getting into this process. I brought together five guys. Where'd that number come from? Before we got to the place of signing, two of them weren't included. So we ended up with three, and we started the process just like Barney and George had done.
In what has been called an arranged marriage, John Schenck, Tom Huster, and Brent Krueger became the new owners of KCI. Like Barney Kloster, Doug stayed on following the sale and helped smooth the transition.
You go from being the leader to being a teacher, and now you're trying to just push them in directions in small ways.
Other than my dad, who will have been the largest influence on me, Doug is definitely number two. You're kind of handing your baby to some proverbial kids and saying, don't screw it up.
They were all valuable lessons. It was school of hard knocks, and you guys don't understand. I've been here before. You haven't been here before. It's too easy on you. And in some ways it was.
But the good times were short-lived.
I think it was May of 08 is when we signed on to buy the company, took on a lot of debt.
Realized that in 2008 they signed a document and I signed a document.
And then the world collapses, you know, the economy collapses. The three of us young guys are looking at each other like, man, what did we just do? Doug said at the time, don't worry about it, the government will step in, they'll infuse a bunch of money into infrastructure, that's what we do.
And Doug was right. The government infused billions into the infrastructure and KCI stayed busy during the recession. As they navigated through the economic crisis, the three new owners were still getting to know each other.
When you're in an arranged marriage, initially you're just trying to get to know who the people are, families, kids, what they care about, what their passions are.
You know, it's interesting that as we're getting to know each other, we're also now running a company.
And it was working. Brent ran the outside, Tom ran the inside, and John managed the outstate work. And they delivered some of their most important projects to date. After nearly 10 years of success, it was time for more changes at the top. Tom Huster took over as president in 2017. And a year later, John Schenck retired. Then, after teaching his final lesson and completing the $126 million St. Louis County Courts building, Doug Jones left KCI.
It'll be my company until I'm dead. There's too many people there that I know.
Doug played one of the most important roles in company history, bridging the gap between the family era and the modern era, paving the way for its current growth.
When I started here, the offices up and down this hallway were not full. Now we have people doubled up in offices and we're asking people to go to job sites and just out of space.
So KCI will soon build a new office in Maryland Heights. Today, KCI marches on with bridges, roadways, buildings, and more.
You know, where is this company headed? It's the same. It's continuing the path it's been on for 100 years. It's, you know, it's hard to believe that it's been around for 100 years, right?
It's neat to think all the way back to what it started with and what was being constructed and all the different projects for all the different owners throughout the years.
I hope the legacy is that KCI just keeps going because it's a great company to work for.
The Charles and Georges and Barneys, I would imagine they'd be surprised.
I think if my uncle was there, if he was still around, truth be told, I think he would be busting his buttons.
He would be proud that the company's still around, the company has thrived.
For this organization to have hit its 100th year, that includes generational family transitions, I think is pretty incredible.
It's like we've been around for 100, why not another 100, right?
The legacy, then and now, starts and ends with the talented people that have called KCI home throughout the years.
I wish I knew personally every person who worked for us, right? I can't thank them enough for what they do for the company.
Thank you, that's what I want to say. I want to say hard work, it's a heck of a commitment. There's a lot of time away. You spend more time at work than you do with your family. I hope we, as an entire organization, are able to and continue to build something that we're all proud of.
From the beginning, this company has been defined by its quality work, strong character, and unwavering integrity.
If that's the history of the Closters of character and integrity and, you know, on through Doug and Rick and on to us, I'd consider us a success.
The ongoing commitment to excellence.
I've really enjoyed all the work that we do here.
The friendly people.
The welcoming feeling of a new beginning.
It's the people, hands down.
I like working here because everybody's like family.
I'm thankful for working with amazing people.
You're made to feel like you're a part of something.
They want to invest in the equipment. They want to grow.
I'm really busy and I like the people I work with.
The flexibility I have to do my job. People come first.
All I have to do is show up every day and work hard and they've always treated me good.
I enjoy my colleagues and the people that I work with.
The group of guys. The enthusiasm that everybody brings to work each day.
The people, everybody takes care of each other.
It's a relatively small company and it gives you an opportunity to meet everyone.
The feeling that it's a family.
The support from the office when needed.
Like the work that we do, self-perform work.
Yourself. Get the job done, mostly.
You're not just a number, they know your name and they treat you like family.
Oh, I guess the spirit piece.
The people.
Everything I get to work on.
The diverse amount of projects that we do.
It's great people. We do a wide range of projects.
I like seeing the job start and finish.
I got a pretty good safety program.
We get along good that way.
The people.
The people are the best at KCI.
The support I get from team members and from other employees.
The unique or the not typical projects.
Take on many challenging projects.
I feel like they put more stock in their employees than anywhere I've ever worked.
For all the different scopes of work we do and all the people that we've worked with.
Our no-fear attitude towards the most challenging projects in the area.
Love working with the guys around here. The crews are really good.
The camaraderie of the employees and the opportunity for growth.
The self-performed work and the type of work we do.
So it feels like family to me.